Come on, everybody, get your heart engaged. God is moving. Would you sing it with us, everyone? By His Spirit.
This evening, the presentation that you're about to see is of an appearance that took place over the skies of Arizona 43 years ago, February 28th of 1963. This mysterious event was witnessed by numerous people all over the state of Arizona and surrounding states. It was a mystery that baffled the scientific world of 1963. For they could find no logical explanation to this wondrous event. Even today, in this year of 2006, the scientific community is still puzzled and have no explanation to how this could have formed or happened. In the summer of 1997 and in other years, there have been several sightings of strange lights that were in a pyramid formation over the skies of Phoenix, that the scientific community have no explanation to this. But you see, nothing can compare to this event that was so widely publicized and witnessed by so many in 1963. This mysterious event was the appearing of a strikingly beautiful and mysterious cloud that swept northward across Arizona. Some who saw the cloud estimated it to be 30 miles across and 26 miles high. They observed that it remained bright 28 minutes after the sun had set. To observers that were directly underneath the cloud, the colors green and blue were visible, and they noted a pinkish cast at times. Within days, more than 200 reports poured into the University of Arizona's Institute of Atmospheric Physics. In an answer to a request made by Dr. James E. McDonald, this celestial phenomenon left waves of publicity in its wake. Both the Arizona Republic and the Phoenix Gazette printed stories. Science magazine included it in its issue of April 19th of 1963, entitled Stratosphere Cloud. Life magazine carried it in its May 17th issue of the same year. Under the content section, it was entitled Odd Sights at Heights, Haunting Photographs of a Moonbeam Rainbow and a Cloud Ring Too Big to Be True. The magazine Weatherwise also published an article in its June 1963 edition. It was entitled Cloud Ring in the Upper Stratosphere. You can find that in page 99. It even appeared in the Encyclopedia Britannica's Book of the Year for 1964. This book relates all the events that took place in 1963. In the meteorology section, page 564. Now, none of these publications had the answer to what this mysterious cloud was. Not even Dr. McDonald, who was of the Institute of Atmospheric Physics of the University of Arizona in Tucson. The cloud ring originated approximately 40 miles northwest of Tucson, Arizona, around a mountain peak in the Coronado National Forest called Sunset Peak. It was drifting in a northward direction towards Prescott and Flagstaff. As you can see in this map, this is the direction it drifted in. It was during this time that numerous people saw this magnificent sight in the heavens. This picture was taken in Camp Verde, Arizona by Clarence E. Peterson of Bremerton, Washington, and appeared in the front cover of Science Magazine, April the 29th of 1963, volume 140, number 3564. This is a photocopy of the front cover of that magazine. The article written was quite extensive. Here is but a portion of the article as it appeared. Ring-shaped cloud seen at sunset on February 28th of 1963 in northern Arizona and areas of nearby states. The height, as estimated from four photographs made in Tucson, Arizona, about 190 miles to the south of the cloud, which appeared overhead near Flagstaff, is about 35 kilometers. This photo was taken by Clarence E. Peterson of Bremerton, Washington, while he was looking almost due north from Camp Verde, Arizona. The unusual nature of the cloud was evident to observers who noted its striking luminosity long after the sun had set at ground level. It was at least 11 kilometers higher than previously reported in aqueous clouds of the Arctic type. Its true nature is still unknown. More photos are being sought for triangulation purposes. See page 292. Friends, this is what James E. McDonald wrote in this article of Science Magazine in April 19th of 1963. May I point out one outstanding piece of evidence, and that is that all the experts agreed that the cloud was at such an extreme height that no water drops or ice particles could exist at that height to form a cloud, adding even more mystery to this phenomenon. This picture appeared in the issue of Life magazine, May 17, 1963, page 112, and the title under the contents reads, Haunting Photographs of a Moonbeam Rainbow and a Cloud Ring Too Big to Be True. The article on page 112 reads, Hovering like a giant smoke ring, a great cloud appeared at sunset over Flagstaff, Arizona last February 28th. That set off a continuing scientific mystery. Watchers, struck by the cloud's odd shape and huge size, took pictures like these four at different times and from widely scattered locations in the state. Dr. James McDonald, a meteorologist at the Institute of Atmospheric Physics in Tucson, has been accumulating the pictures. Using them as the basis for trigonometric calculation, he has made a startling discovery, and that is that the cloud was at least 26 miles high and 30 miles across. A lot higher and bigger, he says, than a cloud should be. The circle of the cloud was too high to be made by a jet plane, and as far as Dr. McDonald can determine, there were no rockets, rocket planes, or bombs being tested nearby that day. He hopes anyone else with pictures will lend them to him, for he would like more clues about the cloud that was 26 miles high, where no water droplets exist at that height to make a cloud. This book is the Encyclopedia Britannica Book of the Year for 1964. This book relates all the outstanding events that happened in 1963. Scientists couldn't help but put an article of this mystery cloud in the meteorology section, page 564. The article, which was written by Clarence E. Peterson, reads, Stratospheric cloud which appeared over Flagstaff, Arizona, February 28th of 1963. It was estimated by James E. McDonald, meteorologist at the University of Arizona's Institute of Atmospheric Physics in Tucson, that the 37-mile-long cloud was formed at a height of nearly 115,000 feet, about 16,000 feet higher than any cloud previously seen. Friends, as you can see, after a full year had gone by, the scientific community was no closer to solving the mystery of how this cloud could have formed at a height of 115,000 feet above the Earth's surface. Far higher, 20 to 30 kilometers higher than any other cloud previously recorded. To summarize and conclude, these are the facts. This mystery cloud formed at an altitude where no moisture exists to form a cloud. As many as 200 reports came in after a request by Dr. James Z. McDonald. As many as 85 known photographs were taken from 35 different locations, with reports coming in from Santa Fe, Albuquerque, Alamogordo, Truth and Consequences, and Las Cruces, New Mexico. It was reliably reported by a woman in Center, Colorado also. The most distant sighting that was reliably checked was made in Juarez, Mexico, by a Mr. J.H. Buell's of El Paso, Texas. Mr. Buell's location was approximately 380 miles from the cloud. After the extensive search and investigation by science, the following hypotheses were ruled out. They say it was not a contrail, which is the condensation trail of a jet plane. Contrails do not form above 24 kilometers. The research aircraft named the X-15 can fly well above 140,000 feet. But the contrails of this aircraft does not form above 27 kilometers. Furthermore, new X-15 flights had been recorded prior to the 28th of February, and this was according to information that was obtained by Edwards Air Force Base. No atomic devices were detonated at the Nevada Atomic Explosion Test Site prior to or after the 28th. Friends, look, these are many of several hypotheses that were laid to rest after the investigation had concluded. What was the scientific conclusion? It's this. It is impossible, completely impossible for any clouds to form at the height that this cloud was recorded. This is an illustration of the layers of Earth's atmosphere. The troposphere is where all the weather takes place. It starts at the Earth's surface and goes up to 14 kilometers. There is a thin buffer zone between the troposphere and the next layer called the tropopause. Above the troposphere is the stratosphere, which starts at 18 kilometers above the surface of the Earth and goes up to 50 kilometers high. The ozone layer lies in the upper part of the stratosphere. Above the stratosphere is the mesosphere. Above the mesosphere is the ionosphere. May I remind you that this mystery cloud formed at a height of 43 kilometers above the Earth's surface, right around the area where the ozone layer is at. The Holy Scriptures tell us that throughout the history of mankind, since God started dealing with him in the Garden of Eden, he's always used signs in the heavens above and in the earth below, as spoken by the prophet Joel in chapters 2. He says that God would show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood, fire, and pillars of smoke, and great earthquakes shall be in divers places, and famines, and pestilences, and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven. In the books of the Bible, the scripture is full of proof that God uses signs in heaven and in earth to make himself known or to show himself to his people. He made a covenant with the prophet Noah after the flood and gave him a perpetual sign of the covenant by placing a huge rainbow in the heavens. That sign is still with us today. With the prophet Moses, he appeared as a burning bush which was not consumed by the fire. God also gave him two signs, which were the staff turning into a serpent and the sign of the leprosy in his hand, followed by 10 plagues never before seen by man. The last one being the angel of death that took the life of all the firstborn. The most outstanding sign that was given to the prophet Moses and the children of Israel is to be found in Exodus chapter 13. And the scene opens as the Israelites have just fled Egypt and are traveling towards the Red Sea. Verse 21 reads, "And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go by day and by night. He took not away the pillar of the cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people." Friends, this phenomenon led them for 40 years in the desert. It is no small surprise why the surrounding nations were so terrified of the God of the Israelites. In the prophet Daniel's night visions, he says, "Behold, one like unto the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven." Daniel 7:13. On Mount Transfiguration, while the Apostle Peter was speaking about building three tabernacles, behold, the Bible says, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice out of the cloud that said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am pleased. Hear ye him." That's Matthew 17:5. In Matthew 24:3, the disciples asked Jesus about the sign of his coming and of the end of the world, and Jesus in verse 30 says, "And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. They shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory." Friends, all four Gospels testify to the Son of Man appearing in the cloud of heaven. In the book of Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, when Jesus was raptured up into heaven on Mount Olivet, he says, "And when he, Jesus, had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. While they looked toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men by them in white apparel. They said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Brothers, friends, relatives, for true Bible-believing Christians around the world, the fact that God shows wonders and signs in the heavens comes as no small surprise, being that throughout the history of the events that happen in the Bible, God has not changed his method of speaking to his children. Hebrews 13:8 states that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amos 3:7 says that surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets. One of these Christians in our day was a simple man by the name of William Marion Branham. About 2 months before the formation of the cloud that appeared over Arizona on the 28th of February 1963, this man was in his bedroom waiting to take his daughter to a nursing volunteer program called the Candy Stripers when suddenly he found himself in a vision. Let's hear him tell us in his own words what took place that Saturday morning.
And that was all right. We'd been up about 2 hours or three, I guess. And my daughter, one of them, Rebecca, back there, she works at the Methodist Hospital in Louisville. Is all that amateur form of nurse training. It's candy stripers, they call them, or something like that. And she was, they called her to come over that morning, and that's what got me up. And it's early, and she with some other little school colleague here, they worked there together and was going to take them over to Louisville. They had to be there at 10 o'clock. And the wife wondered why she couldn't get in the bedroom. I had it locked. Now, I have had many things to happen in my life, but I never had anything like that. I went into a trance. I don't know the interpretation. I've never had anything like it in my life. But before me, it seemingly that I realized that it was a vision and I was in the vision. But I was talking to my son, Joseph, which he was not in the room at the time. But somehow, just as it struck me, I was talking to Joseph. And I looked up, and kind of in the shape of a pyramid, standing before me, was a little small bird, something like a half inch long. And they were up at the top on the limbs. There was a, they say, three or four, and next limb had maybe 8 or 10, and down at the bottom had 15 or 20. And they were little warriors because their feathers was beaten and looked like they were trying to talk to me, saying something. And I was in the west, seemingly around Tucson, Arizona. And the birds were looking east, and I was listening close. Looked like they were trying to tell me something. And they had little feathers, was all been beat up and things. They were pretty well battle-scarred. Then all of a sudden, one bird began to take the other one's place, jumping like that, and the little birds swiftly left flying eastward. And when they did, from that came a larger bird, more like doves with a pointed wings. And they come in a swarm, and swiftly, more swift than what the little birds was, flew eastward. And I still, in my the two consciences together, I knowed I was standing here and I knowed I was somewhere else, see? And I thought, now this is vision and I must learn what this means. And no more than the second group of birds come by, I looked to the west. And it looked like in the form of a pyramid, like two on each side with one on the top, came five of the mightiest angels I ever seen in my life. Such a terrific speed, I never seen their heads back and their pointed wings just sailing quickly. And the power of Almighty God struck me in such a way that it lifted me plumb from the ground, all the way from the ground, up. I could hear Joseph still speaking and sound like a sound barrier breaking, that a great roar went off way in the distance to the south. And when I was lifted up, and there was such a terrific speed of the angels, and I can just see them right now, see, as they were coming, and that shape like that, just sweeping right into me. And I'm not dreaming now. No, I was right there, wide awake as I am now, see. But here it come, and they were so terrifically fast that I thought when it lifted up, I heard that explosion like, or like a blast that went out, like a sound barrier, and when it did, I thought, well, this must mean that I'm fixing to be killed, see, in a blast of some sort. While I thought on those things, I thought, no, it wouldn't be that, because if it was a blast, it would have got Joseph too, because there he is still talking, thinking I'm there. I can hear him. It wasn't that. Now, this is all still in the vision. It's in the vision. And then all at once, as I realized that they were around me, I couldn't see them, but I've been brought into this constellation of a pyramid of them, inside this constellation of angels, of five. And I thought, death angel would be one, five would be grace. I was thinking that. I thought, oh, it's coming with my message. That's my second climax. They're coming to bring me the message from the Lord. And I screamed out with all my might, as loud as I could, oh, Jesus, what would you have me do? And when I did, it just went away from me. I haven't felt just right. You can't think of things like that then. I can't anyhow. And I thought, just troubled, upset. You don't know how to think. You can't think. And I said, Heavenly Father, if that meant that an explosion was going to take me, well, let me know now, so I'll say nothing about it. Let your glory and power come up on me again and lift me up again, or let your glory come up on me, and then I'll know then that it meant that. And so I can keep it to myself. And nothing happened. So then I said, then, Lord, if it meant that you're going to send your messengers for my commission, then let thy power come again and like cut me out of the room.
I've
come to myself with my Bible in my hand, and asking God to help me. And when I did, he showed me something in the Scripture pertained right to it, right there.
Amen.
And I thought, could that actually be that? How'd I do that? And I can't explain these things, folks. It's beyond anything I know about, see?
This simple man had a vision from the Lord that showed that he was somewhere in the west around Tucson, Arizona, where this vision took place. During the first week of January of 1963, this man, following the instructions given by God through another vision, arrived in Tucson with his family. In the same month, in a Christian convention held in Phoenix, he related the details of the vision of the coming of the seven angels and told the people present that they were to watch because something was going to happen. And that something happened on February 28th of 1963. It was the fulfillment of the dream that he had had on December the 22nd of 1962. About 40 miles northeast of Tucson. Let's hear him relate to us what happened in his own words.
It's the vindication of your ministry. I was going hunting with a friend, not knowing what was going to happen. And someone called me, the one that criticized me about that picture of the angel of the Lord, the one that took it. I had to go to Houston about his son, or he's going in the death row, he's going to be killed in a few days. He met me there and threw his arms around me and said, think the very man that I criticized comes to save my only son. The Humane Society gave me an Oscar, whatever you want to call it, for saving a life. Then we went back. I went up in the mountain to hunt. There, Brother Fred and I, one morning when I walked down, I'd already got my Javelina, and I looked and seen the place where we went. I said, Brother Fred, go over on that mountain early in the morning now, about to break a day, and I'll get on the other. I won't shoot at the hog, won't kill him, but if they start over this way, they're hurt, I'll shoot in front of them and run them back. Brother Fred went out there, and there's no hogs. He waved at me, and I seen I went down in a canyon, some big chasms. Sun is just coming up. I come around the other side of the hill, not thinking nothing about the prophecies. Sit down, waiting, resting. I thought, what happened to those hogs? I picked up my sat down like Indians do, you know, cross-legged. And I looked on my overhaul leg, and there was a bullheader. I picked it up. I said, that's strange. Here I am about 40 miles northeast of Tucson. There's my little boy Joseph sitting there waiting for me. And as I started to look, I seen a herd of hogs come out about 1,000 yards from me up on a mountain. I throw the bullheader down. I said, I'll get him. I'll go get Brother Fred, and I hang up a piece of paper to let know which way to go on this old cotilla here, and we'll get Brother Fred, and I start up the mountain running as hard as I could on the other side. All of a sudden,
I thought somebody shot me. I never heard such a blast that shook the whole country. And when it did, standing before me was seven angels in a cluster. I met Brother Fred and Emma Lou. They said, "What was that?" That was it. What are you going to do? Return home. For thus saith the Lord, the seven mysteries that's been hid in the Bible all these years, these denominations and everything, God is going to open those seven mysteries to us in the seven seals. Amen. There was that circle coming up from the earth like a mist forming. When it did, it went plumb up into the mountain, began to circle on westward from the way it come. Science found it after a while, 30 miles high and 25 miles across, just exactly in the circle of the pyramid. And the other day, standing there, turned the picture to the right, and there's Jesus. Amen. As he was in the seven church ages. Amen. The white wig on, showing supreme deity. He's Alpha and Omega. He's the first and the last. He is the supreme judge of all eternity. Standing there to confirm the message of this hour. And there shall be light about the evening time. What's it all about? What was it? I went westward up on that same mountain, passing up with Banks Woods there, said, "Throw up a rock." Was his wig. Yeah. Amen. Amen. What's happened up on Mount Sunset? God confirming his word. That's what all this noise is about. Notice, it's God fulfilling his promised word again of Revelations 10, 1 to 7. And in the days of the sounding of the seventh angel's message, the mystery of God should be finished. The hidden mystery of Revelations 10, 1 to 7, the last message to the last church age. Fulfills exactly in this age, St. Luke 17:30, the day when the Son of Man shall be revealed. And there shall rise false prophets and false Christs, show great signs and wonders, insomuch to deceive the elected, if possible. The people still in doubt. And as usual, the church is just as puzzled. And the science, all through Tucson, yet they're writing pieces and putting the paper way back around Mount Lemmon, that big canvas. Didn't see it rising up from where we were standing. Drifting on towards the west, showing the time is over. It can't go but a little piece there. It's at the west coast. Judgment struck just in the very way it went. Going right up over Phoenix, right on across. On to Prescott, across the mountains, to the west coast, right on up into, where was they going? Right on up into Alaska. And she's thundering, heading right that way. And the observatories and all of them in Tucson are still asking research of science, trying to find out what it is. So high there can't be fog, mist, or nothing up there. What did it? Where's it at? They're just as puzzled at that supernatural halo hanging down in the sky as it was when the Magi's come in, following a star, saying, "Where is he? That's born King of the Jews." What was it? God fulfilling his word. Amen. There shall rise a star out of Jacob. And the God of heaven promised the evening time would have evening lights. 3 years ago, this mystery was a prophecy. What time is it, sir? But now, it's history. Amen. It's past. The promise is fulfilled. What time is it, sir? And what's this attraction? God fulfilling his word. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Let us pray. Dear God.
Friends, as you can see, the appearing of this cloud was not for the benefit of science. It was a fulfillment of a vision that God had showed a simple, humble preacher from Indiana on December the 22nd of 1962. That fulfillment, my brothers, happened February 28th of 1963. His name was William Marion Branham.
I believe God, I'm going to hold on. Now I believe all things are.
Let's hum it like this. Now I receive. Do you? Receive his word? Now.